The RAD Live podcast is intended for mature audiences and contains explicit language. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome to this week's edition of the RAD Live Podcast Random Ass Discussion. I am your host, Paul THG, the Hat Guy Flinders. And joining me this week, we have the lost one himself, Adam Cox.
Hello.
We have the almost scouse one, Lewis Ogden.
Hello.
And we have the return of the kilt-wearing, caber-tosser.
It's Alexander Nicol. Spit it out, mate. Fucking hell.
At least it weren't as bad as last week's intro. I completely balls that up big time. Oh, God. Turn the intro off. But yeah, I'm Paul. It's, I'm completely off my stride now. Off. Who's been up to summit?
Been up to fucking nothing.
2 weeks of nothing.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, I mean, if you're gonna go person by person,
I'll start you. Fuck it, go on.
Oh, cheers. Bar literally work, recording for the new podcast, and watching wrestling. I haven't really been doing that much.
When he means wrestling, he means mostly New Japan.
Yes.
Oh.
Has to be New Japan.
It. I wouldn't have it any other way.
This is it. Now, while I say why you're bringing up New Japan, I know it's very early on. I mean, we're not even 3 minutes in, but WrestleBox is back.
Yeah.
And it is now Lewis's baby. Lewis Ogden.
It is my baby.
So basically, what WrestleBox is now, what we used to be was, obviously, it was our first podcast, and the classic episodes will be going up on Patreon whenever I can get time to download them, because I don't have them anymore. Basically, what it is now is Lewis is basically going to basically just lovingly talk about what he likes about wrestling, basically. Why don't you share what you're planning?
Well, first off, I'd like to say you use the term basically more than Attitude Era Triple H. basically, the whole WrestleBox podcast, all it is now is talking about independent stuff. So mainly non-WWE stuff. May touch on NXT a little bit and all other sort of like outside projects like that. But it's mainly independent shows, like talking about like New Japan stuff and everything that's going on there. And it's just basically, it's random ass discussion about independent wrestling.
Yeah, pretty much. And at the helm, obviously, you have yourself, Lewis Ogden. And maybe guests at times. Whatever it is up to you. It is your baby now.
You take guests. If anybody feels that they can contribute, then more than welcome to join me.
Maybe Matt, if he's interested.
Probably something that I'd have to discuss with him.
Yeah,
but,
put some feelers out, see if you're up to it. You never know.
Uh-huh.
I know he used to enjoy doing WrestleBox way back in the day, so he might, you know, he might enjoy doing a podcast without Darren. So...
That's understandable.
But yeah, sorry, go on, Coxie.
No, I'm just saying shots fired.
Oops. Thing is, though, with the day we do podcasting at the minute, I don't think it's going to be a long time before we have Darren live on the show. So, because he's basically works every Saturday. I'm not saying that's a good or a bad thing. I'm being diplomatic there.
He's also retired from podcasts.
Oh, he's retired from podcasts, yes.
Oh, thank crap. I mean, oh, no. Whatever shall we do?
Yeah. Xander!
Yes, buddy.
It's been a while.
Worst section of the track.
Yeah. At the minute, Xander's trying to multitask because he's currently trying to qualify for a race in the...
He's in race.
He's in the race now.
He's doing the UK GT3 Championship around Barcelona. Currently, I've got a 5-second lead.
Ah, it's going to be our job to fuck it up for him.
The race is an hour long with a pit stop.
Yeah.
That's commitment for you.
Yeah. Me and Xander used to do longer than that.
Yeah, an hour long is nothing.
Yeah, we used to do like 4, 5, 6 hours sometimes.
And he also used to play racing games quite a lot as well.
All I'm saying is I wish. So yes, Andy, you've been up to much, matey, if you can multitask that much.
Not really, mate. Just getting by, to be fair.
It's about to be the shortest intro ever.
Da-da-da! No, not really. Same old stuff that everyone else has to do.
No, just
shopping, wash cars, wax cars, look after annoying screaming brats.
Wax on, wax off.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, we don't wax our car. We get someone to we don't even wax it. We just wash it, but we get someone else to wash it. So we don't even do that.
Lazy bastard.
It cost us £6. Sorry, it went up £6 because we've got a bigger car now.
Cost me nothing because I did it myself.
Yeah, you probably tickle it with branches off the trunk of a tree that you picked up out of the road. Use it as a brush.
He's got to defrost it first because it's no doubt. Just...
Have you noticed it's lovely and warm at the moment? It's at least 13 degrees.
I thought you'd say, I'll have you know it's lovely and warm in my fridge.
it's like winter is here. What is it? Is it, what, 2, 3? No, minus 13 daily.
That's a nice autumn day.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's not a nice day. Jesus. So then, okay then. Coxie, you've been up so much.
Yeah, well, I wasn't in town last week, was I?
He wasn't in here town. There's somebody that's done something.
away down in London town.
He was.
For what the Lost Evenings Festival, amongst other things.
Yeah. So the Lost Evenings Festival, that was Frank Turner, wasn't it?
Was, yeah. So he played all four nights, and I went to all four nights.
And he was a very happy man, I'm assuming.
Yes.
It was fucking good.
Well, there was that, and I did some touristy shit as well, which I haven't done before in London. So
you were a tourist?
I was a tourist, yeah.
What's it like showed, on the other side of the fence?
Fucking weird.
You went to the Two Swords, didn't you?
I did Two Swords. The Dungeons, Sea Life, the London Eye River Cruise. So, yeah, it was good. I did a bit of the War Museum as well. That was really good.
Oh, cool. I mean, I've only ever done one War Museum, and that was when I went to Jersey, and I went down the German war tunnels, which was cool.
This one, it's like the Imperial War Museum. It's free to go in, but it's like 4 or 5 floors. So, like, one floor is World War One, another floor is World War Two, then you've got another... Something else, and so on, like working up.
That sounds cool.
You can probably spend like about 4 hours in there.
Ah, that's not bad. I reckon I would dig that. Honestly, I'd have to give it. To be fair, I've got to get to London first, so still not.
Yeah.
We'll do one day.
So I did that. I drank quite a bit.
Yeah.
I ate quite a bit.
Yeah.
And I walked quite a bit.
We had to work the calories off somehow. We didn't drink that much.
You've got to compensate somewhere. Yeah.
There's got to be some compensation. They don't like me otherwise.
I've got the record here of what I did.
You got a record?
Well, I've got like a step count on my phone.
Oh, right.
So, the Saturday, I did 26,789 steps.
How many?
26,789.
Fuck.
That's equals 12 miles or 1,200 calories burnt.
So that's the Preston.
Then you find out he was just shaking the phone.
He was getting his exercise some other way.
Strapped to his wrist.
The Sunday, I did 22,037.
He attached it to a stray dog.
So London must have been pretty lonely then.
Fuck you all.
But yeah, it sounds like you burnt a few calories, mate. In fact, you burnt anything, it sounds like you probably lost weight, mate, rather than putting it on with the food.
I haven't, because we went to, we found a donut shop in Camden Market, which
shit.
Donut. And they were on like £3, so I had like a raspberry jam donut, but it was mahoosive.
Oh god, it was like a life ring.
Well, it was more like a rock, like you'd kill someone with it and eat the evidence. Like you...
Jeez.
One of them sort.
A disposable murder weapon.
Yeah.
Jesus fucking Christ. That does sound actually pretty awesome. I am partial to the odd donut. Speaking of which, I remember years ago, you and the G-Man were talking about certain donuts in Morrison's.
Yeah.
A long time ago. The cola ones.
There was the cola ones, but we had the ongoing debate of the best supermarket donuts.
It never ended. It never ended, this debate.
It didn't, but, well, he doesn't do it anymore, does he? So
no, he's retired. But I was in Morrison's the other week, actually. I was looking for these donuts. I was like, they're not there. They're all... I did, like, the Beale thing. Like, They're all gone.
The cola ones were, like, a really sort of limited edition. Cause yeah. They did, and a fruit salad one.
I gathered that. The only ones they had were raspberry, and that was literally it. I mean, you remember when I was listening to the podcast way back when, and you had all these, like, it was like a whole range of different flavours. I walk in, raspberry or fuck all. Basically, it was like, what's happened? You changed?
Still have, like, custard on that.
Yeah, but, yeah, raspberry or custard or nout, basically.
Yeah.
What choice is that? you could have had cola. I wanted a cola donut. You know, you recommended it, and it was like, everything you've recommended, I've really enjoyed. For example, the jelly nut burger. And I was like, he must be right about this, so I wanted to try it, and it was gone.
That episode is probably like 2 years old, though, now.
Oh, it is, to be fair. It is, to be fair. But I thought it was like being a regular thing, because I thought, hang on, the way it was going on was like, Morrison's must be, like, synonymous with funky donut flavours. And I was like, well, surely they must still do something weird in there. Because you know what I'm like for this podcast? I'll try and find the weird and the wonderful to try on the air.
Yeah.
And that was my plan. And then I was like, there's nothing here. It's raspberry or custard. What a cop-out is this? But hey-ho, we will find something, which I have. Which we'll get into very, very shortly. Because I still have a certain witness sat, you know, about 20 foot behind me wanting to see how I get on with this thing. But yeah, sorry, go on, mate.
I was going to say, I thought you'd have waited for, like, the adverts. So you can eat it and they go, right, we're going to adverts.
Oh, what fun is that? What
Welcome back to the second half of the show. I'm still dying.
Well, what fun is that if I'm crippled halfway through? Well, if
thank
I'm
you, darling.
I start the show. Oh, Razander's got a brew. mid-race, might I add. We've missed that. We have missed that.
That's how you properly multitask.
Absolutely. He's podcasting, drinking a brew, and driving at the same time. I'm sure there's an offence in there somewhere.
Well, 10 seconds in the lead.
Drinking a brew, 10 seconds in the lead. Next thing you know, I'll have a top hat and a monocle.
So you're saying you were 10 seconds in the lead. That's surely enough time to go and make the brew yourself.
Did a fuck.
I'm just saying you're that good at multitasking.
I'm going to have to check your gender next time. Because surely you're multitasking way too well for a male.
I just locked up there.
He can't multitask.
Well, that multitasking talent was short-lived.
Lost 9/10.
Oops. So yeah, what have I been up to the past couple of weeks? I got a new phone. It's all right. Managed to get a free Spotify on it though, which is cool. 2 years worth for free, and PSN for free for 12 months. So that's all good. What else have I been up to? Work. Pretty much that's it. Oh, doggy obedience training for the dog, not for me. Went well. That was it, pretty much. Not really done much, if I'm really honest. It's been, another quiet one.
Don't lie, the dog obedience training was for you.
Yeah.
Instead of sitting on the step, when you get told off, you get sent to the cage.
Kirsty was sick and tired of him wiping his ass on the carpet.
I told you to go and get those hemorrhoids sorted out.
I like the sensation. Can't go on. Fucking hell. Moving along.
That at rapid speed, but using your hands.
Speaking of dogs, she's jumping up at me now after my item that I'm going to eat in a second, just to test on the show. Because we're doing it now, because, like I say, someone wants to see me, suffer. Yeah, so the dog is jumping
All the listeners want to hear you suffer as well.
Yeah, this is true. This is what I've hyped the show about. I put a post about it, yesterday, whilst I was defrosting it in the fridge. The dog is really interested in it, so I'm going to have to get on with it, I think, before the dog decides to nick it and run off across the garden with it.
Then you'll have to call out the on-call vet.
The on-call vet straight away.
And she starts getting stomach ulcers and stuff like that.
Yeah, and, projectile shitting all over the fence and all the wood stain it.
It won't even be the fence. She won't be able to hold it.
No, just turn into a shit-fueled rocket, basically. We don't want that, so we'll leave that to me.
Tickling her chin and she starts painting your wall.
Self-defense mechanism, they'll just point her in the right direction and away you go. Who's fapping? Anyway, it could be on the steering wheel. Sorry. We may as well move on to it because, someone's waiting here with bated breath to watch me suffer, so. Yesterday I put a post on. Well, I went shopping yesterday and there was a post about a month ago? It was in April, wasn't it, where Iceland released the UK's hottest chicken thighs.
I hate Iceland.
Yeah, Iceland. Thank you.
Yeah, Morrison did like that hottest curry or whatever, then whilst it Iceland was like, we'll do hot stuff, forget it, we'll do some hot chicken legs or wings or whatever it is.
This is it. I mean, Iceland have got these hot thighs out, which have been out for about a month now. And to be honest with you, I got in there was loads. So I think a few people tried them, and I'm assuming that's a sign that people are fucking scared. Because when you go to Morrison's and you try and get this stupidly hot curry that's out and available, usually there's only like one left on the shelf or something like that. But these, there's not many of them. So yeah, this could be interesting. Now, a few details about these. Obviously, I've done a bit of research on them. The Scoville scale, the value for that is 575,000 on the Scoville unit scale. Now, to compare that, Coxie, 10-minute burn, was that
1.4? 1.1, I think.
1.1, so these are just over half that. And you was in considerable pain.
Yeah.
So and
your 20-minute burn was 1.2.
Yeah.
Not, your Hell Unleashed, I think it was 1.2, whatever it was.
Well, the one I had.
There was one I think it was 20 minute burns on the 1.2 or Hell Unleashed. I think it's hotter than that. But I don't know
yeah,
what
I
this
think go- it was like 2 point something, wasn't it? The one I had the extract.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was 2 point. I'm sure it was like 2.2 or something ridiculous like that.
Oh, I've no idea.
It was fucking hot anyway. But yeah, it was ridiculously hot. So this is about a quarter of the heat of that. So we'll see. They created it by combining three types of chilies. Bird's eye, habanero, and something called essence of capsicum or cassipium. But that's just like a... say that word.
Is it capsicum or capsaicin?
Yeah, which is a group of plants, which is basically ranging anything from a red pepper right up to, like, you know, hot, really, really hot chili. So it could be fucking anything.
Well, essence is always hotter because it's just the heat, no yeah. flavour.
Yeah, so, yeah, that's going to be fun. So we've got those mixed in.
Capsicum's now, bell pepper.
What's that, mate?
Capsicum's based like a bell pepper.
Yeah, so, could be fun. So, yeah, I've already cooked it. Defrosted it last night. You've got to defrost them for 24 hours in the fridge before you cook them. And then they take an hour wrapped in tin foil in the oven. So there's quite a bit of preparation needed for these, just, you know, just to get them in the oven, you know, and eat them. So, yeah, unfortunately, I cooked this earlier, so it's gone cold. But, obviously, the heat and everything will still be, you know, as good as it was. It just looks like your stereotypical chicken thigh. Just looks a little bit angrier, shall we say. So, I'm just going to give it a good sniff now. And that does smell potent. Now, one thing I must know, if you see these in Iceland, it will literally just say red hot chicken thighs. They do not say they are the British, UK's hottest chicken legs. It's as if to say, it's as if it's luring you in with a false sense of security. Yeah, they're hot. No, these are fucking hot. So, yeah, I'm actually holding them now. I can actually kind of feel my finger burning. Which is fun. Off the grease, the heat from the grease, so.
That might be the habanero.
It could be. So, yeah. So, yeah, I'm going to bite it now, so. If I die, fuck you all. Here we go.
And a big thank you, fuck you, bye to you too.
Right. Here we go. Biting it now.
Thank you, fuck you, bear. Boom.
Right, massive bite there. Instant heat. Very nice. Almost disappointed, actually.
But
that's us pitting.
You were
perfect time for that, it. Weren't you? Yep.
It's building, though. Heat's building.
Will build.
Ooh, it's one of them. Yeah, starts off slow and then...
Yeah, it's building. Big style building. Oh, it's right at the back of the throat now. Oh, they're good, actually. I'm going to take that back. The heat on them is top notch. But it's not unbearable.
And it's still building.
It's slightly building. What can you tell?
Yeah, because you sort of like, your voice is elevated quite a bit.
I can feel one mouthful, I can feel it round my lips burning nicely. I can feel it actually on my tonsils.
I speak from experience, right, when I know that it'll still be burning for a bit.
Yeah.
An arrow in it and shit. So.
Yeah, it's very, very, it is very pleasant. I'm actually going for a second bite. Here we go. Second bite. I highly recommend these, by the way. They are fucking lovely. Hot though, but really, really nice. That second one, oh, you can tell, second one. Ooh. Ooh.
Quick, give him some water to fan that heat.
No water.
Water!
Dog's the dog's looking now as if, can I have some, please? No.
Close pipe.
Yeah.
Thirsty water!
If you can handle Vindaloo, you can handle... Well, a little bit. If you can handle the fall, you can handle that.
Just need Kurt Angle to come in with a milk truck. With Jim Ross going, Milk-o-mania!
But yeah, they are top notch. Absolutely top notch. Can't wait to try them hot. As in, like, out the oven hot. I mean, not spicy hot, obviously. Dog's jumping up now trying to find the chicken. Get down, you daft bugger. Yeah, absolutely 100% recommend them. Get them down your neck, Coxie.
I may give them a try.
You need to. £3 they are for 760 grams of them.
That's not bad.
That's really good. £3. I've got 4 thighs in my packet.
How much?
For £3.
That's not bad at all.
Really good price for me, that. Now, there is something else that I need to get my hands on, which I've seen advertised, and it is, again, heat-related. Aldi have now released something. Coxie, I don't know if you've seen this.
What's that?
It is ghost pepper sausages.
Oh, they've been, that's been shared in like the group chat for bloody ages.
So I am going to, as soon as I can source a pack of these ghost pepper sausages, I will be trying them on the show. And I may actually save them for a podcast.
Yeah.
And film it.
That'll be difficult unless you bring down like cooked sausages and go over it. I'm just bringing these in.
Hide them in your trousers.
I've just cut my sausage up and pulling it out of my trousers.
Yeah.
Showing everyone the pink elephant trick.
I was listening back to the prediction. I think it was the Mania Predictions pod, and we were talking about a prize for the actual the winners or the winners
of the predictions.
Yeah. Because
that was me and Lewis, wasn't it?
With Lewis Drew.
Yes.
And we said it was going to be like some Morrison's ghost pepper sauce or something.
Oh, fucking hell. Oh, now then. I've just got on this chicken the skin. And it's all chock-a-block full of that stuff.
Yeah.
I'm going to eat the chicken in one. The skin in one. With all like the herbs and well, not herbs. Is it fucking... like the habanero and the goat bird's eye and whatever else is in there, so...
Yeah.
Here we go.
It's all war, too.
Make it worse. Go ahead. Yeah. Mm-mm. Nice.
The one... Well, two...
Oh, shit!
You've done it now.
At that moment, he realized.
Made a big mistake.
At that moment, he realized he'd fucked up.
If I lose the WWF Championship match, I will
set my throat on fire.
Death by chicken.
That would really change Kane's backstory.
Instead of being Devil's favourite demon, he's just a man that really likes spicy food.
Instead of being nicknamed the Devil's favourite demon, he's the Devil's favourite chicken. Or instead of being burned alive inside of a funeral home, he's burned alive inside like a KFC restaurant.
He falls in a vat of stag chili. Fucking hellfire.
Well, why do you have to call it stag? Yeah, you both owed a prize for that, so we'll talk that for you for the next podcast.
Ooh, you're a very nice man. So, now I've tried my hot chicken, and it was bloody lovely, and I've got to say, that's probably one of the nicest things I've ever tasted on this show.
Easy. I lost track of what I was saying then, I forgot, but it's...
It's people, all
right, man. People have told me a couple of different methods of, like, cooling down heat.
Oh, right, yes.
You've eaten some of it, and it's like Kaylee off of... she's always having like a beer. I was like, does beer not make it worse? And she's like, nope. I was like, I think it does.
It does for me. I'll be honest with you. I remember having vindaloos and things like that, and I've had like a can of Carling or something like that, and it just makes it worse. There's something wrong with her if that makes it better.
Depends how spicy it is, though.
Well, we're talking Vindaloo levels for me.
Vindaloo's not that bad.
Just heat in general.
Yeah, just heat in general.
We've got Xander with like the steel arse here or something.
That's only because it's been surgically repaired.
That's Scots are known for it.
Yep. Scotch bonnet.
Someone recommended was honey.
Honey?
Yogurt would surely be the best bet.
Yogurt?
Yeah.
Or ice cream.
Yogurt would work, or yogurt, ice cream, or anything sort of milk-based, dairy-based, whatever, because it's got milk in it. But then another one someone recommended was a hot drink, like a hot cup of tea.
Oh, no, it makes it so much worse for me.
I think it makes it worse. I mean, overall, yeah, because obviously if you've got a milky brew, i.e. the Bobby Lashley, it does eventually calm it down. But initially, because of the heat of the drink, I think it fucking makes it worse.
Well, I think you can have... I've tried this theory myself, and for me it seems to work, but only on, like, nothing overly hot. But I've had, like, an actual hot... I can smell drink hot brews. But I don't like my tea milky. I had it standard as it was, and it was fine. Like, it actually got rid of the heat, but it was a mild heat.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, can we just go back 1 second?
Yeah.
Paul, did you refer to Bobby Lashley as the Milky Brew?
Yes.
Yes,
I did.
Would you care to elaborate on that? Because I'm a bit freaking baffled about...
Well, Bobby Lashley, when people were talking about Bobby Lashley, you know, about being this, like, awesome wrestler, and this and the other, I was like, well, he's not that good. He really isn't. You wouldn't complain if he was on your card. You know, if you went to a show and he was on it, he's not going to be one of these people that's a deal breaker.
Yeah.
But you're not going to pay to see him.
No.
He's the milky brew of wrestling. Because if someone gives it you're going to drink it, but you certainly wouldn't fucking ask for it.
I don't know. I quite like milky coffees.
So do I.
I find sometimes they're better than regular brews.
Ah, you're wrong.
No, I'm not.
You're a Bobby Lashley fan.
I've even got Xander to back me up. I'm not, because I'm not even a WWE fan. I can't classify myself as a WWE fan when I don't watch the fucking television show and I stop watching the pay-per-views as well.
Yeah, fair point. I mean, I've even watched Backlash myself, so...
I didn't want to.
I heard the reports from him. I was like, I'd rather shit in my hands and clap, if I'm brutally honest.
I heard the reports, and then I heard the multitude of podcasts just tearing it to fucking pieces, and that was how I enjoyed.
That pay-per-view made me flaccid, just from the sheer lack of anything on the card.
It was a massive nothing burger, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Massive nothing burger. I mean... What have we got out coming out of that now? I mean, man, I've not even watched... Do you know what, actually, really? I've not really watched the product since WrestleMania, if I'm honest.
You're not missing much.
Exactly. I mean, recently, what for Money in the Bank, we've got Ronda Rousey versus Nia Jax.
Yeah.
Why? Just why?
Mad,
but other than that, I really don't care. I'm not following anything. I'd be on giving a fuck about the product, if I'm brutally honest. And because I've stepped away from watching the local promotion, I don't really watch wrestling at the minute much anymore, if I'm brutally honest.
Mm-hmm.
So, well,
which I watched Better Than the Bollard last night.
You watched what?
I watched Better Than the Bollard last night. Live.
Okay,
on
go. Oh, yes. Oh, it was live. You watched it live. I know we've got a new PCW champion.
Yes.
But I think there's a reason behind that, because WWE have decided to start pulling the people on their contracts away from TV deals. So, for example, what's the one that I know of? Can't remember, but T-Bone is obviously WWE contracted. And he was the champ, wasn't he? So, obviously, if he's not going to be allowed to appear on IPPV,
mm-hmm.
he's going to be dropping the belt. But he's also tag champ, isn't he?
I think he was a tag champ. No, yeah, he was a tag champ, because now it's Shara and Jester. But it's one of them. What is it? They've gone to the bloody. He's one in the tournament, isn't he? Again.
Yeah, it's gonna be one of them guys. Is gonna go out the first round again.
Possibly, yeah.
Yeah, download. Was it not download? It is download. Sorry, isn't it?
Is where the round tournament. Yeah, first round.
Well, seeing as we're talking about, obviously, the UK tournament now, should we go straight into it?
Yeah, go for it.
Because Xander can then concentrate on his racing. the tournament competitors have been announced. Now, for what we would do is, obviously, where is the UK tournament being held this year? It's in London, isn't it?
Royal Albert Hall. They're having the first round matches at the Download Festival.
Yes.
And then the UK shows go on the 18th and 19th, I believe. I know it's a Monday and Tuesday.
Yeah, which is the 2 days.
It's the weekend preceding. Yeah, it's the 18th and 19th because it's the weekend preceding NXT Chicago and the Money in the Bank.
What a week of sport that is, then. I mean, I will probably get back into it, or try and get back into it for that reason, at that point. I've got Le Mans that weekend. And then I've got, obviously, you've got the UK tournament the 2 days after. And then, obviously, you've got, would you say Money in the Bank?
No, that's the weekend before. So when you're watching Le Mans, I'm guessing it's that weekend.
Yeah, so it's literally the two that you have Le Mans, and then it's literally straight after that. It's
the 16th, 17th.
Yes, Le Mans.
Yeah, so the NXT show's on the Saturday, and the Sunday show's got Money in the Bank.
Right.
And then the Monday and Tuesday after that are the UK shows.
Right, that's a mental weekend then.
That's a pretty mental weekend, yeah.
So, yeah, we've got that coming up. Now, initially, I was a bit pissed off with them not coming back to Blackpool. But then I realised they can't hold... Is the roof still fucked in the Empress Ballroom?
Yeah, they're still doing work on it, I believe.
Yeah, so there's no way they could have actually put the show there. So, shits and giggles as well.
There was rumours they were looking at going to the Tower Circus, from what I heard, at one point.
Interesting.
But of course, with PCW been there, from sort of what I've heard, possibly rumours and stuff, is that Flutter has an exclusivity agreement with the Tower, so that anyone else who wants to run a show there has to pay him X amount of money.
Oh, fucking hell!
So, it was when they had Uha come over. And everyone was like, sort of, this rumour got around of, oh, they might be doing a show. The WWE might be doing a show at the Tower because they can't do a show at the Winter Gardens. But then it's like, oh, well, they've got to pay X amount to PCW or whatever for exclusivity rights. But then they might have sort of tried swaying them and saying, oh, well, you can have Uha.
Right. Oh, well, fucking hell. No, man, maybe they'll come back. We'll see. It'd be nice. But it depends how it all comes off in the UK tournament this time round. But yeah, we got announced the competitors for the tournament this time round, and Yeah, what I thought we'd do, we'd rattle them off one by one and give our opinions on them, if there is anyone, any on that opinion. So, first off, we have Zach Gibson.
Probably the most underrated heel going on the British independent circuit today.
Yeah, nicknamed Liverpool's number one.
Mm-hmm.
And I've seen him, I've only seen limited stuff from him. I saw a little bit of him in Five Star. The limited amount that I saw him at PCW, really, really, really good.
And he's a very effective heel.
Yeah, I've only heard good stuff about him.
And I've trained with him and with James Drake as well, and they're both very down to earth. So it's nice to see them getting the opportunities.
Speaking of James Drake, he's also been announced.
Uh-huh.
Which is a local boy.
Yeah.
From Blackpool.
He's originally from Livham, isn't he?
Yes.
Yep.
I trained with him about 10 years ago when he was 15, 16. Which is really weird.
Yeah, so obviously Cox is going to be rooting for him. Gotta be.
Yep.
Gotta be. Home, but if you're from Blackpool, you gotta be. It's the same that Sam Gradwell's not been invited back. But
this is what I don't get. They put Drew Gulak in it. He's like, holding this. It's not the UK tournament.
Well.
And also, I swear there was a match either on NXT or during the NXT tapings where Jack Gallagher beat Drew Gulak, or whether it was somebody else. I can't remember. But I swear it was Drew Gulak who he beat to get entered into this tournament.
Possibly.
Right.
So maybe there was someone who got injured and they replaced him with him instead, possibly. We shall see. But yeah, next one, obviously you've just said that Drew Gulak's been announced. Meh, I don't know much about him apart from what's on 205 Live. I know he's good in the ring. But yeah, I'm not that knowledgeable on him, for brutally honest. Another one that you just mentioned as well was Jack Gallagher.
Yep.
Very, not underrated anymore, but yeah, very, very capable guy. Deserves to be in it. Joe Coffey. Joe Coffey's been announced. Mostly famous for ICW, and was he on, he was on Five Star, wasn't he? Was he, or was he on British, World of Sport?
I think he was World of Sport.
Yeah, I think he was a World of Sport as well.
Did he want to do What Culture as well or something, possibly?
Yes, he did. He did What Culture as well. Again, another capable guy. Very good. One of my personal favourites in the British wrestling scene, Dave Mastiff.
Oh, yeah.
Big Dave.
The Black Country Bastard.
The Black Country Bastard, absolutely. And you've got to put him down as a tip to win it.
I'd like to say so. I'm not certain he will or not.
I think he'll impress.
I know who my pick's going to be.
I think he's going to impress.
Yeah.
I think he'll be one of the standouts from this tournament, a bit like Piper Niven was for the women's tournament.
Mm-hmm.
When you see him kip up, your mind is going to blow. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah.
We have all seen him. Well, me, Coxie, and Lewis have seen him do it in person, and it's a sight to behold.
I've seen him. To be fair, I've seen him do a springboard moonsalt.
Yeah, I've seen him do that.
We as well.
I've seen him do that. It was a match against Rampage Brown at the TNA British Boot Camp tapings that I saw. I was just sort of like, fuck.
How's he pulling this shit off?
Yeah. much like I did with Uha the very first time I saw him. My fucking mind was blown.
Yeah, we saw Uha do his shit for the first time. Literally, it was like jaws on floor all over. Instantly over with the crowd.
Mm-hmm. I saw Master do it at Future Shock and Cyanide. It was like these two massive guys against each other. Mm. And those where it's like, Mastiff was like, what can I do to finish him? Like, just to put him down. You just see him look at the. You see him look at the turnbuckle. And you shrug his shoulder, goes, "Okay," and just thumbs up. And I literally leapt out of my seat, like, 'cause I'd never seen him do it before. I was like, "That's fucking amazing."
Yeah, Yeah, I can't. Yeah, I mean, Cyanide's another good guy. It was underrated as well. The one thing that sticks out for me when someone mentions the wrestler Cyanide is that move at Too Good To Be Two that he did, which was like the Samoan drop kick combo on the team single.
Yeah.
Which was insane. Who's making a dirty phone call?
It's not me.
Who's heavy breathing?
Oh, that was me.
Ah, have you binned it?
He's engrossed.
No. I lost the rear coming around last corner onto the straight of Barcelona. Lost like 3 seconds because of it.
Oops. But yeah, moving on to the list, we have the next one on the list is El Ligero.
I think Ligero is sort of like up there with Zach Gibson of who I'm most pleased is in the tournament.
Yeah, I agree.
Given that he's like got the reputation of being probably the hardest working independent wrestler I think I've ever heard of.
Yeah, I mean, he does like fucking at one point I remember I had him on my personal Facebook at one point, and he was doing like 12 shows in a week.
Yeah.
Something daft like that. And he's flying to different countries. And I don't mean just going to like Wales and Scotland and things. He was fucking wrestling in Switzerland. And then the next day he's got a match in a little fucking village hall somewhere down south.
Yeah.
It's insane what the guy's work rate. Mm-hmm. Insane. The fact that the guy's...
Sorry, sometimes two or three shows a day. Like he's in... We're doing All-Stars. We do like a show in Skegness. And a show in Bognor Regis. And the following day might have like a show in the morning in some church hall. And he's back in like two shows for All Star again.
Yeah, he's a mentalist. He's got such a high work rate. If anything, we're going to a WWE schedule, there'll be a break for him. You know, it's insane. He wants to slow down now, so he's going to sign for WWE. You know, it's one of those. I mean, the guy's got such a work ethic and such a... I want to do something, so I'm going to go and do it. For example, as well, I sold this guy a Nintendo, and he drove from Leeds just to pick up a Nintendo and drove back.
Yeah.
So, it's ridiculous what the guy is doing. He's such a hard worker. He's so good. He's really good in the ring. He's got in such great condition.
Yeah.
You know, what's not to like? His gimmick works. What I don't like, though, is the building from Leeds. They're billing him from Leeds.
He's on the road all the time. How do you have the time to play it?
It's his downtime. He has a bit of downtime, you know, a couple of hours a day, maybe.
They should have like his Madman Manson sort of gimmick, where you just sort of like go coming from the back seat of his car because he pretty much never goes home because he's always on the road,
hailing from wherever the fuck he is right now.
Hailing from Salford Service Station.
Coming out the back of a Vauxhall Corsa. Yeah, Ligero. Out of everyone there, on sheer work rate, the guy deserves it the most.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. No, hands down, no brainer. Next on the list we have going down is Kenny Williams.
Very decent worker.
Very decent worker. Very decent worker. I've seen him a few times in person. I can't say I can fault anything he's done. Again, another guy that deserves the call. Whether he's going to be one of the top guys in this tournament remains to be seen, but yeah, he deserves to be there.
I've enjoyed him whenever he's been in the ring, and he was the first guy who was part of my first ever refereeing. Dealing with Bobby.
Yes, you refereed a whole show.
Yeah, and his match was the first on the card.
Was that him against a certain wrestler that's not mentioned?
No, it was against... Who was it?
I know you had an issue with a certain wrestler.
That certain wrestler was in the main event.
Yeah.
Who the fuck was he against? I think it was one of the Academy guys. I think it was Jack Barron.
Aye.
Yeah, it will have been Jack Barron.
Ah, oh, fair dues. So yeah, you could your first ever referee gig, and yeah, he's now in the UK tournament. So I'm assuming you're going to have a little bit of a soft spot for him in this tournament.
Well, there's lots of people that I have soft spots for, but
yeah,
there's one in particular.
Yeah, which we're probably going to get to at some point.
Yeah.
Next up, we have Joseph Connors, who I've only seen relatively a couple of times. I think he has been at PCW, but only a couple of times, I believe.
I can't recall ever seeing the name's familiar, but I don't think the show that he'd been on. I think I've either not been there or I don't know.
I'm sure I've seen him at least one Rumble. And I'm sure I've seen him in a couple of other matches. I'm not 100% though.
He is the current world champion for TNT, which is the promotion down in Liverpool.
Mm.
And I know on the next show that they're doing, he's defending the title against Walter. So.
Oh, fuck. His ear might match, it might get chopped off, literally.
Yeah, take a chest protector. You'll need one.
Yeah, I would. I'd have Joey Hayes for his. Next one on the list, we've got Amir Jordan, who I've never heard of.
I've heard of him. Can't remember. No, it was Roy Johnson who was in last year's tournament.
Yeah.
I've heard about him. Sort of like, don't know too much about him, but he's obviously in there for a reason.
Yeah, obviously he's got something about him, so I'm willing to give him a chance. So we'll see. Next up on the list, we have Travis Banks.
I see. Progress World Champion.
Yeah. This guy has probably risen the ranks in the British scene quicker than anyone else. I remember him doing an academy. He was on the very first academy show at PCW. He was on there. I remember he had a little bit of a Rabsy Nesbitt gimmick going on where he had like an orange vest top sort of thing.
I remember that. It sort of like looked a little bit like Timmy Mallett.
Yes, and he grabbed my hat and threw it across the room, and I never got it back to the end of the show. decent. He's really, really good.
It's nice to see that he's put that much amount of effort and work into sort of getting to the top, and he's been given a chance to shine.
Absolutely, the guy deserves it. Even though he's not British and it's in the UK tournament, the guy deserves it.
Yeah. Well, to be honest with you, it's mainly over here, and then.
Yeah.
Well, the only thing I can think of with him going over to the States is probably PWG, but it's mainly over here that he works.
Yeah,
which,
he's based 99% of his work is over here. Same with Tony Storm.
Yeah, it's nice to see, and with him being the Progress champion, it's probably a good shot that he might make it to the final four, or maybe a bit further.
And with their working relationship with WWE, he might even be able to bring the Progress to belt with him.
Yeah.
So that would be nice.
Do what New Japan do with the Revolution Pro belts.
Yeah, absolutely. Pleased he's on the card. Next up, we have Jordan Devlin. The only exposure I've had to him was last year's UK tournament, and he was all right. So can't complain on this one either.
They, from what I heard, I saw a video or something. They noted him as Finn Balor's protege.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's about it. That's all I know.
Well, he's Finn Balor's protege, and he was involved in that controversial finish from the first round of last year's tournament, where the guy pretty much like split the back of his head open, and they ended it quickly, even though he kicked out.
Yeah, that was nasty. That's the one that Darren was in attendance of, wasn't it? The first show.
Mm.
Yeah, he got moved down because his seats were either had lighting or a camera, so they moved him up. So he had like the perfect view right outside the ramp. So, next on the list, because we talked about James Drake, we talked about Drew Gulak, one of our favourites, Ashton Smith.
Nice to see Ashton there. It was probably the biggest surprise.
but the guy's got talent. The guy's great.
He's a very good fiery babyface.
Yeah. Can't fault that. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen a bad... When I've been at PCW, I don't think I've ever actually seen a bad Ashton Smith match.
Mm.
I don't, genuinely don't think I've seen a bad one. It's again, I don't know what he's done in other promotions. I know Mateus has seen him down in Liverpool. Yeah, he's good. The guy's good. He's got the look as well. So, yeah, absolutely. Ashton Smith 100% deserves to be in this.
Yep.
So, yeah, moving on. Again, making his return, Tyson Tebow. Who doesn't like Tyson Tebow, let's be honest.
Yeah, he's a cool guy.
Further this year, I reckon.
You what, mate?
I reckon he could go further this year.
I hope so. I genuinely hope so. I mean, he's been working in the gym, hasn't he? I know he has been working.
Yeah, so. I believe he's kept the gimmick, hasn't he, as well?
Yeah, he's kept hold of the gimmick and worked the gimmick. So, absolutely.
Well, one of the things that I can remember, because this was still when I was at the PCW Academy, is that they were talking about his basically his Gypsy Traveller gimmick. One of the things that they were going to do when the plans for doing the UK TV show,
yeah,
when they were still up in the air, one of the trajectories that they were thinking of going with his character was getting more and more incomprehensible. So it would get to the stage where we would need like a translator to translate everything that he was saying.
Jesus.
When he goes full gimmick with it, he sort of toned down the gimmick recently on the indies, but I reckon once, because they've announced him for this tournament now, it's
going to work it in again.
Yeah.
But the thing is, he's not going to be on TV on the gimmicks anymore, with the gimmick anymore, if that's the case. So he can go full-blooded like with it and use it as practice for the TV show that's coming.
Yeah.
We'll have to see. Next on the list, we have Flash Morgan Webster. Now, I don't recall ever seeing him in person. I did see the one match on 5-star, and he was all right.
He was
on 205 Live as well, wasn't he? But I've not seen the match.
Did you? The only experience that I've had from seeing him live is did you ever go to the Chris Travis charity?
Oh
show?
Yes, I did.
It was in the multi-man match.
Oh right, okay.
I distinctly remember it there because I tried doing Flash from Blackadder.
Oh yeah.
I tried doing quotes from him and it didn't really work.
See, the only thing we did on that Travis Memorial show was insult Marty Scurll. Now, me and Simon was at the time Marty Scurll was a presenter of WrestleTalk on Challenge. And he took over from Joel Ross after all what happened with the Lionheart breaking his neck shit and all that lot.
Yeah.
And, me and Simon decided it would be a good idea to chant "You're just a shit Joel Ross" at him. Repeatedly. And he came up to me, Simon, and grabbed us by the scruff of the throat and then walked off.
And that's when you started going whoop 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 whoop, and he's just sort of like, "Oh right, this would be good for a future gimmick."
But yeah, so we nearly got battered by Marty Scurll. But yeah, Flash Morgan Webster of the tournament. I can't say much about him, to be honest.
I've seen matches of him in Progress, and he's very, very good.
So, I'm not really keen on the gimmick. I've found. I've not.
Yeah, that's it. I'm not really sure about this mafiosa.
Well, he's the mod father, isn't he?
Yeah.
But
I don't know. Maybe it worked better. Maybe it worked better if he gets a chance to play it.
Again, this video, the video I watched, I think it was like a WWE video, and they're like, oh yeah, but he brings like some charisma and character into it, whatever. It's like, well, yeah, he's worked in his gimmick, whatever, because he is the mod father, and it's all mods and bloody the Who and all that sort of shite. But I've seen him like two or three times, but it's like it was almost like the same match every time. It's going through, almost like going through the motions. Like,
oh yeah,
I don't know if it's just me or.
Like I said, I've not seen many matches of what he's done, so I can't really comment. But yeah, moving on. Last person on the list that's been announced is Tucker. Now, again, the only exposure I've had of Tucker was from last year's tournament, and he had a fucking amazing match, didn't he? On the first end of the first night,
it was the best. Tyler Bate. It was Tyler Bate. It was the best match of that first night, to be honest with you.
Yeah, he deserves another crack at it, absolutely.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So what do you think, Coxie?
I've not seen this Tucker guy, so I can't really comment. I've not even heard of him until they announced the tournament.
He's decent. I mean, he was in last year's tournament, and he did, had a really good match with Tyler Bates. So, you know, he does deserve another crack at it. Whether he'd go further again or not, I don't know. Obviously, half of these are not going to make it past Download. So, you know, it's one of them. Is there anyone that's not even been mentioned?
Lewis Ogden.
Fuck that. I'd probably be put in a match with Dave Mastiff and just get fucking cannonballed and pinned within 10 seconds.
Oh, it would be like every single match at the White Collar Wrestling where the guy comes out and all of a sudden you start hearing fucking in the bushes and you think, oh shit.
Fucking pelt for the freaking fire exit. Fuck this.
Fucking run. Yeah, fucking run. Or, who would you, in the UK scene at this minute, just very quickly before we go on break, is there anyone that's not been mentioned who you would like to have seen signed to this UK tournament?
I don't know about anybody independently. I'm surprised. The one person from the WWE UK roster who I'm surprised hasn't been called back for the tournament has been Mark Andrews.
But he's doing 205 live stuff, isn't he, at the minute?
Well, yeah, but even sort of like, well, apart from the Cruiserweight title tournament, has he really been featured that much on 205 live?
Not really.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, unless they're thinking about maybe doing something with him in NXT, which I'd like to see. I'd like to see it. I mean, I'd probably say that's probably the most glaring name that's been left off. In terms of people from the independent scene,
Joey Hayes.
And I think Joey Hayes would be more. I think Joey Hayes is tied down with World of Sport. I think.
Possibly.
I think he's tied down with World of Sport.
We'll have a look.
You will have a look. What about Tozan?
He isn't. No, he isn't. Probably needs a bit more experience under his belt. He's got the physique and the stature. I remember him posting last week, or weekend just gone, about him, about that particular night was his 100th wrestling match. So maybe get like another year and a bit under the belt and they'll come a knocking.
Yeah, he's guaranteed. The guy's really good. He works hard. He's got a great attitude.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's If he does not get to the WWE, it's a crime. An absolute crime.
Well, you've got to think that he's on their radar. Absolutely. Given that when they had the tryouts late last year, he took part in it.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't surprise me. And, you know, I'd say fair play to him, because he's been one of very few people who I've had the pleasure of training with that I could see sort of the drive to want to get to that level.
Yeah, maybe you're right. But yeah, the guy, maybe if they're still doing the UK tournament in a couple of years' time, we'll see him on there. Possibly. But yeah, the fucking guy deserves it, man. Absolutely. Anyone you'd like to see on there, Coxie?
Oh, God. You put me on the spot here now.
Can't think of anyone, it's cool.
It's just, there's no one really that comes to mind. Like, I'm out of touch with British wrestling at the moment, and that I've not watched anything for God knows how long. I think that the last, before PCB last night, I can't remember the last show I went to or watched or anything.
Probably the last one I went to was the one with you, it's at Circus.
Oh, yes, I did the circus show, the last circus show PCW did. But I enjoyed the Joey Janela one more, I found.
Oh, Spring Break?
Yeah, but no, the Big Top Adventure.
Yeah, that's the one we went to.
Well, yeah, but I went to Spring Slam.
Oh, right, I see.
Though that may have been sort of, may not have helped the fact I was sat next to Dick Fate all night.
Oh, fucking hell.
Flatface.
Yes, Flatface.
Oh, Flatface.
Well, the woman in front of him, the woman in front of us was filming, and he kept sort of trying to reach over to actually tap her phone. And then he went to do it, and she turned around, and he's like, yeah, you can't record in here. And she went, all right, sorry, I didn't know that, and then put her phone away. And then he looks over at me, I'm looking at him, and he looks over at me, and he's there like that, sort of like mashing his hand into his, his fist into his palm. And I just went, what are you doing? He went, and then he looks at the woman and went, I will smash your phone if you record. And then went, you won't, because I'll break everything you've got. And he's like, he went, but I will smash your phone. And I went, well, but if you do, I will break your fingers. But then he went, he remembered something I said to him about white collar, and he went, well, is that your mum? I said, no. He said, well, I can smash your phone then, can't I? I said, no.
What kind of fucked up mentality is that?
I am the law.
I am the table.
He's got the intelligence of one anyway.
I am the table. I'll fucking put you through a table if you're not fucking careful, you prick. He probably takes some of the remnants of the table and fucking hang it on his wall.
Turn it into a shrine.
He'd do a review of it and ask you to sign it, then go, this is the table I got put through by Lewis. So if you see here, I asked him to sign it, and this is where he wrote fuck off on it.
And as you can quite clearly see, the blood stain. The blood you can make out in the blood smear.
But
the phrase thank you, fuck you, bye.
Yes.
He went on another one of his tangents of I wanna be as big as The Rock, and it's like, it's not gonna happen. Why? Because you don't do enough training or anything. You're not Samoan.
You're not Samoan. Yeah, that's what's gonna really hold him back.
It is, though, isn't it? He's half, The Rock's half African, half Samoan, essentially. African American, even. But then it's like, I said to him, how often do you go to the gym? He's like, 3 times a week. But how much do you do at the gym? He's like, about an hour. Is that right? So you go to the gym 3 times a week for an hour, so that's 3 hours a week compared to him who probably does 40 hours a week in the gym. And follows a strict diet and all that sort of thing. Is like, do you see where I'm coming from? I'm still going to try, And the guy next to me is like, no, just give up, mate, just give up. He goes, I don't think wrestling's for you. But then the entire night, the entire rest of the show, he's like reeling over to me and going, it's like, does John Cena still train?
Of course he fucking does.
No, he meant like wrestling train.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, what do you mean? He's like, does he still train to wrestle? I was like,
I love the way he looks at you as if you're Dave Meltzer.
Oh, well, he mentioned Dave Meltzer because he messaged me at one point and went, you're going to this WrestleCon in Manchester? I said, no. And he went, but Dave Meltzer's there. I said, yeah, I don't know. I'm not going to pay to meet him unless I'm at a show or something. It's like, oh, Dave Meltzer stood there, sort of thing. Like Matthew of Botchamania. And he's going, have you met Matthew? Yeah. What's he like? Is he nice? I'm like, yeah. But again, I said, where did you see him? I saw him here. Well, at PCW, twice. I stood with him and did live alternate commentary at one show. He's like, how'd you meet him? Well, I was stood next to him and then just went, hello, Matthew from Botchamania. So.
I remember the night I went drinking with a few mates and Matthew from Botchamania, which was, you know, quite an experience.
And we did try and do this once and it was so clicky, it was fucking awful. I mean, it was one of the shows, I can't remember which one it was, at PCW, and we stayed behind and we had a drink with Greg Lambert and Stallion, and that was it. That was pretty much it. Because everyone was all in the groups, and it was like, well, you don't want to jump in.
No.
I was like, do you know what? Fuck this shit. It's crap. Because we were just sat in a corner. Well, sat, not even in a corner. We were sat on, well, stood by the dance floor having a drink and thought, fuck this shit. We're going to the hotel. Fuck it.
Well, that's what we did. It was just sort of like all the wrestlers were planning on like going out to the pubs, the bars and clubs, and we were just sort of like, yeah, but there's a bar at the hotel. So we'd literally just stayed there till about 2 o'clock in the morning. It was fucking great.
Yeah. And when we got to the hotel, because it must have been the ROH weekend, because we got to the hotel and it was Red Dragon were in there drinking with Joanna Rose.
Yeah.
So, but we did. I don't know why, we just left him alone, just fucking called it a night, I think.
Didn't want to be that guy.
Yeah, didn't want to be that guy. Go, oh, look, it's Red Dragon. No, I'm not one of that. I leave people alone.
Hello.
Hello, I'm Dick Fate. I sound like Scooby-Doo.
Hello, will you sign my mixtape?
Oh, Jesus Christ. We need to go for a break because we're an hour and a quarter in. So, yeah. We'll have a very brief advert break. We'll go make tinkles and have a drink, and we will be right back after these messages.
Hey, Foxy, reminding you to check out the Lost Art Podcasting. We cover reviews, interviews, listener topics, our own topics. We even take a general look at life and the world around us. So, I'll find the Lost Art Podcasting on Spreaker, Stitcher, iTunes, even YouTube, and all of the good podcast places.
Hello, this is for...
Can't we say hello at the same time?
Fuck's sake.
Hello!
This is an advertisement for Master Debaters.
Oh, can we say Master Debaters together as well? Yeah?
Hello!
I am Michael.
I'm Sean.
I'm Toffer.
And we are the Master Debaters.
We are the Master Debaters.
That's what we want
to
do.
We're all saying it.
Yeah.
Hello!
I'm Michael.
I'm Sean.
I'm Toffer.
And we are the
Damn it, Sean! I thought we were just doing...
Hello!
I'm Michael.
I'm Sean.
I'm Toffer.
We are...
The Master Debaters!
You can find us on Twitter, @_MasterDebaters, SoundCloud, Podbean, and iTunes. Just do yourself a favour and jump aboard this podcast train.
Choo-choo, motherfucker!
It's a mam.
Hello, mam.
Ain't a daughter.
Hello, Stacey.
Just telling it like they think they ought to.
I'd love to meet a pirate.
Ruff giraffe. Ruff giraffe.
Melodic sound of the flute.
They'll make you pee your pants when you laugh.
Wet and maggoty.
Funny chat.
Comedy bronze.
Sketchy facts.
Dog monk.
And advice from a very wonky cat.
Kipper.
Ruff giraffe.
Sometimes sober.
Ruff giraffe.
Cheese maggots.
On Podbean and Apple Podcasts.
It's not like they don't know what they're getting. If you like hilarious chat and poorly researched facts, then Ruff Giraffe is for you. You can follow us on Twitter at Ruff Giraffe Pod or find us on Facebook. You can download and subscribe to the show on your favourite podcatcher.
Thank you for listening to the RAD podcast. If you really enjoy this podcast, please consider supporting us by going to the RAD Live Facebook page at www.facebook.com/UKRADLive. You can also find us on Twitter. Our handle is at UKRAD podcast. You can find this podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, and many other good podcast apps and websites. And while you're supporting us, consider supporting our friends at The Lost Art of Podcasting. You can find them also on Facebook by going to the www.facebook.com/Lost Art of Podcasting. They are also on Twitter and have a handle at Lost Art Podcast. They are also on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, and many other good podcast apps. Same also for his spin-off show, The Lost Art of Wrestling. They are also on Facebook at Lost Art Podcast and also on Twitter with their handle at LAOW Podcast. Friends of the show, These People Podcast, great little show. Give them a like, give them a subscribe. You can find them at Facebook at www.facebook.com/These People Podcast. They are also on Twitter at TPPod. They also have a website at www.thesepeoplepodcast.com, and you can find them on Spreaker, iTunes, and many other good apps. Also, while you're at it, Castle Mirth Podcast. Cracking show if you don't mind a little bit more of the risque side of things. They are also have a website of their own as well at www.castlemirth.com. They are on Twitter at CasaMirth and also find them on Facebook. They are also available on iTunes, Stitcher and all other good pod sort of apps out there. And Mooch TV, friends of the show as well. They are on Facebook at www.facebook.com/MoochTV. But you can also find them on YouTube at www.youtube.com/MoochTV. And if you're ever in Blackpool, in the season, might add, because it's now fun, you can go to Reflex, the only bar in Blackpool that has 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and noughties music, also accompanied with great food upstairs in the family bar. So if you're in Blackpool and you enjoy, you know, great food, great music, and a great time, why don't you consider checking out the Reflex at the Foxhall? Now it's back. The RAD Live Podcast. And we are back! Yay! Xander has finished his race and he won by a mile.
A mile.
By a show mile. Off.
He is. No. He's not showing off if you can back it up left, right, and centre. But yeah.
So we'll stop yourself. Stop you trying to. You're starting to sound like Dolph Ziggler.
Well, that's because Xander is the Dolph Ziggler of motorsport.
Well, it's not the winning; it's the taking. It's not the winning; it's the it's the most impressive.
Yeah. So Xander actually wins shit. So, yeah.
So it's nothing like Dolph Ziggler. Then.
No, maybe. All right, maybe not then.
Well, first, point proven.
Yeah, point proven. So we'll start the second half of the show by two questions that our fellow hosts, who have not made it on the show, have left us. And the first one we'll start off with is Darren's question that he recorded for me in the email. He sent me an email with a load of recording, which you will hear nearly 5 minutes worth of audio from Darren towards the end of the show. And he left a load of like sort of like over audio clips and snippets that he left me, which I'll be brutally honest with you, they weren't bad, but they were just questions. Like, at the minute, the way my setup is, I can't seem to be able to play. If I click, for example, this button here.
You done fucked up now!
See, I can hear that the Black, was it Black Dynamite going, you done fucked up.
Yeah.
You listening can hear Black Dynamite saying, you done fucked up. Xander, Lewis and Coxie cannot. Because for some reason, I cannot figure out the settings for them to be able to hear that.
It's... If I'm right in my thinking, so it's something to do with like a mix, what's called a, you need to like a mixed minus setup,
right?
But I could be wrong. No, I think that's what I've got to do with mine because I've got a mixer. So if I'm recording through Spreaker Studio, I need to do a mixed minus setup.
Yeah, whereas I'm just using the onboard Spreaker, the onboard sort of like soundboard and things like that. So.
Well, mine's due to the fact it's like it won't let me currently record until I do a mixed minus setup or whatever. I need to get the proper cables or whatever to do it.
Right. Well, hopefully, because all mine's digital, it should be easy to sort out. So I'll just do a bit of research, and hopefully by the time we come on the show next week or the week after, we'll be able to do all these sound effects and you'll be able to hear them. But yeah, you guys won't be able to hear what Darren says. I don't know if that's a blessing or not. But I'll be able to play that later on. But he left us, like I say, a load of questions. And I'll be honest with you, the only one that I'm going to be able to answer this week is this one that he's left us. And I quote, do you prefer to watch a series all in one go, like a binge watch, or one at a time as like they appear live on air? I will start this off with the one person I think I know the answer's going to be, Xander. How do you like to watch your series?
Binge watch it.
Mm. Any reason why?
Not really. I mean, it's just easier. There are some episodes of certain series we watch when they come out, because we've recorded them. But other ones, like Game of Thrones or Walking Dead, stuff like that, I like to record the whole thing and then just watch it back to back. I find it's just more enjoyable that way.
Mm. I mean, if you can get yourself into the mind for it set and just be able to kick back and relax, just shove it on, I'll give a bit of my answer now. It depends on what it is. I mean, if it's something that's current and it's on the TV, for example, Walking Dead, Game of Thrones, whatever it is that I'm watching. What the thing that me and Coxie watched? It was on Sci-Fi.
Blood Drive.
I watched that as it came out. Coxie managed to acquire it via means, so you watched it in big bulk, didn't you?
I watched, like, sort of, I think when I got it, it was up to, like, episode 6 or something, so I watched, like, episode 1 and 2. Together, and then it was a case of like I was watching episodes when I could, so it'd be like I'd watch episode 3 the day after, or whatever, episode 4 the day after that, and then it'd be like a 6-day stint, so it was when I had free time.
Mm.
Still up to like bloody episode 8.
I think I'm similar. I never watched it all, but I watched it as they came out on air, so when they're on Sci-Fi, that's when I watched them. If I'm catching up though, by fucking all means, I will binge the shit out of it. That's what I did with Walking Dead. That's what I did with Game of Thrones. I will sit there and I will watch as much as I can digest.
I still haven't seen the last season of Game of Thrones yet.
Get it watched because it's good.
It's still on the Skybox.
Yeah, get it watched, man.
Same with Walking Dead.
Walking Dead less so, but definitely Game of Thrones watched. So yeah, it depends on what it is for me. It's more of a timing thing for me. If I'm catching up, I'll watch it all in one big, massive fucking lump. But if it's just on the air at the time, I'll watch it as and when it comes on. So it's just one of those. Lewis, what about you, fella?
I prefer binge watching, to be honest.
Hmm.
There's the simple point being is, one, I liked the availability aspect of it, the fact that I can just sort of like watch three episodes or four episodes of a particular show that I really like and not having to watch the one and then waiting another week for the next one to come out, which is a bit annoying. And two, it really sort of, well, I mean, like, case in point, there's a particular episode of from the current season of Game of Thrones that was leaked early.
Yeah.
Now, I couldn't wait because simply for the fact of reason number two why I like binge watching is that it was almost spoilt for me. So I literally stopped everything that I was doing, went and searched the episode down, and just fucking went and watched it because it was just sort of like, it's going to be spoiled for me if I don't get it watched. And another case in point, on my bookshelf that I've got, I've got three out of the four seasons of Star Wars Rebels, which technically is a kid's show. But to be honest, I don't really give a shit because it's incredibly addictive.
Neither you should.
And yeah, I recently turned Matt onto Star Wars Rebels, and he's in the same camp as me. He thinks it's fucking amazing. So much so that we're searching the cheapest deal possible of getting like the full box set of like the Clone Wars TV series.
Okay.
Because there's a certain character from the prequel trilogy that was sort of jobbed out unceremoniously, and a lot of his backstory has gone into. Which I'm sort of like interested to see because he turns up like partway through Star Wars Rebels, and it's always nice to see him on screen. So I think the fact of sort of like binge watching something that's available to you, you can keep spoiler free, and literally you can just get engrossed in it. There are certain episodes, there are certain TV shows that you watch that you can just get engrossed in and just sort of, you know, you watch 5-6 hours worth and you still want more.
Yeah, I mean, there's loads of examples I can think of. That Game of Thrones is a good one for that. Band of Brothers is a good another good one for that. If you've ever seen Band of Brothers, you'll understand what I mean.
Who hasn't seen Band of Brothers? I mean, come on.
You'll be surprised, mate. You'll be surprised.
He raises his arm.
I watched Band of Brothers when it first came on TV with my dad. Because it was when we were young, essentially.
Yeah.
And then my dad got it for me on DVD when it first came out. You know, the steel box?
Oh, yeah, I've got that.
And when it came out in Blu-ray, I went and bought the Blu-ray box set as well.
Nice.
And every year, me and the missus binge watch Band of Brothers. I've also got the Pacific, but watched it through once and it's just, nah.
It's not as good.
It's just trying to be Band of Brothers too much. Even though it's a show based on real life events,
it lacks the character of Band of Brothers.
Yeah,
Pacific.
You got attached to the platoon.
Yeah,
a lot more
Easy.
In Band of Brothers.
Yeah, you get attached to Easy, where in Pacific it's more about, you know, one or two people.
Mm-hmm.
And it even shows you them going on holiday and stuff like that. So they're escaping the horror of the war.
Yeah.
Whereas Band of Brothers, they didn't. It was all the time. It was like one episode there was like in a town, the next episode they'd be stuck in their own little foxholes for the entire episode. Things like that. It was good. Really, really good. Really, really engrossing.
That's it. The two episodes that are dedicated to Bastogne, the Battle of the Bulge, they're phenomenal. Yeah, in the Pacific, I can't think of any episodes that stand out like that.
No. I agree. Did you say, Coxie, you've not seen Band of Brothers?
Yes, that's correct.
I think you're...
Blasphemy!
Yeah, you need to...
I've got the steel box that I can lend it to you next time I see you.
How many episodes is it?
Ten. Yeah, but he doesn't have to watch the fucking 10th one.
No. Well,
You're probably so invested in the characters anyway that you will watch the 10th episode. But the 10th episode actually is about the real soldiers that was in World War II.
Yeah.
Ooh. Yeah, give it a whirl, honestly.
Once you have Sopranos, I'll let you know.
So yeah, I'm a binger slash I will watch. Do you know what? I'm a fucking fencer, so that's what I am. Xander's a binger. Lewis is a binger. And for the record, Lewis, don't give a shit what other people say about what you watch, whether it's for babies or not. As long as you enjoy it, fuck anyone else.
Oh, yeah.
You know, me and Xander are massive Naruto fans, and depending on who you say, in this country, thinking it's a kid's show, it's not a kid's show.
Well, I watch One Piece as well, and that's been going for 20 years.
Mm.
And again, not a kid's show.
Absolutely.
Or you've got Bleach and stuff like that. Not a kid's show.
No. They toned it down in this country and make it a kid's show.
I'm not bothered about like people, because the thing is, I'll just be like, well, you don't know what you're missing out on.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, I like Paul, you know, I've got young kids. Kids TV is on a lot of the time. I mean, I've seen every episode of Ben and Holly and every episode of fucking Peppa Pig.
Yeah, absolutely. But the thing is, though, if you notice on Peppa Pig, there's a lot of adult humour in it.
Yes.
A lot of adult humour. You've got to think about it. It's like, for the one that sticks out for me is when obviously, Daddy Pig is a builder. He's sort of like an architect sort of thing, isn't he? And he builds houses. And he builds a house for, is it the Wolf family? A family of wolves.
Yes.
And he talks about these and what these houses are made of. And the wolf tests it by blowing at the house. It doesn't blow it down. He goes, it's very strong. And he asks Daddy Pig, so what's your house made out of? And Daddy Pig goes, it's made of brick, so don't even think about it. It's like, Jesus Christ. And there's other ones as well where it's like Peppa Pig's proper like brutal. Like there's an episode where she can't whistle, and she's everyone around her starting whistling. She rings up a mate who thinks she can't whistle, and all of a sudden she just does it one time over the phone. She just fucking point blank hangs up on her. You know which episode I'm on about?
I do, yeah.
So yeah, there's all sorts of little bit weird bits in it, and you think you shouldn't get any sort of enjoyment out of it, but you do.
I get so annoyed a lot of the time with Peppa. It's just like, that's not fucking realistic now, is it, Peppa?
Fucking bad parenting. Yeah, oh god, Coxie, I don't believe we've asked you yet whether you're a binger or a trickler.
I don't know really. I'd lean more towards sort of binging, but it's one of them sort of like I watched 3 or 4 episodes of iZombie last night in one go. But like I'm not one of these where I could do a full season in a day. Like,
oh, I've done that. Funland. That DVD that I recommended to your brother.
Yeah, I did Breaking Bad season 2 in one night. But without realising.
Yeah, you get sucked into it.
So
yeah, that's what happened to me with Funland. That is the RAD recommendation, by the way, is Funland, if you can get hold of it. It's a dark comedy set in Blackpool. And it is fucking brilliant. It's got Chris Marshall in it. It's written by the guys that did the League of Gentlemen?
This is a local shop for local people.
Yeah, it's
your kind is not welcome here.
The same people wrote it, so you can expect that kind of humour. It is fucking brilliant. You need to watch it.
Hi, Dave.
Yeah, yeah, get it watched.
Speaking of Clone Wars, I found all 5 seasons on Blu-ray for £30.
Yeah. Is it on the... Have you got the link on Zavi?
That's the one.
Yeah.
There you go. Great minds think alike.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got three bingers. and one meh, which was me. So
there's always one.
So there's your answer. The second question that we've been given to us today by a host who's not on the show. So this one is from Alan. Why do people leave their common sense at home when they go on holiday?
So I think Alan Lee's appropriating by his new real name now of the Chubby Slim Shady.
Oh yeah, the Chubby Shady, the real Chubby Shady.
Shady was the one.
Yeah, the real Chubby Shady, because he at one point in the past week he dyed his hair. Well, obviously it's a traditional colour, shall we say. He bleached his hair to put a different colour in.
Fat Man Slim, rock the planet, Fat Man Slim.
So yes, Alan is officially, he's lovingly known as the real Chubby Shady now, because it was for a very brief period of time he had basically bleached hair. So yeah, we may have to put the picture up at some point if Alan doesn't mind, obviously.
We have to say this because the original photo was him with the hair dyeing and it was like bleach blonde.
Yes.
So we immediately thought, I immediately thought that he was going for like bleach blonde hair. I was just sort of like, you know, you can't really pull off the real Slim Shady because you're anything but.
Just a transitional phase of his life.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Sort of like go through his midlife crisis.
Play it.
It is.
Fuck.
Copyright.
You fucked up.
No, because we can get around the copyright by then reviewing said song.
It was great. It's a great song.
Yeah, it's all right. It's all right, yeah.
It's a great song. Oh, dear me.
Copyright beaten.
I mean, like, this the song really did, like, it helped one artist's trajectory and just sort of, like, killed the other one, so.
There you go. Using a new phone. See, this is part of the lyrics. I got the perks of this new phone. I've got all 24 months free Spotify premium. Ah! I didn't realise it went this over too many times. I don't skimp it though in case I miss a line now. I think it comes up now, doesn't it? Dear Slim, I wrote you, but you still ain't calling. I left my cell, my pager, and my home. I sent two letters back in autumn. You must not have got them. There probably was a problem. And copyright right there.
I've got Alan's new entrance music.
Have you? He can't stand up, he's too chubby.
Find it.
Yes. I've
the perfect version for Al.
Go on.
One second. I'm just typing it in.
Fucking hellfire, man.
Close.
Figured that he's done himself no favour. You know, he was literally just getting over the Alan G phase.
Yeah, Alan. Yeah. Oh no. Yeah, the honey, honey Al. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
There we go.
Oh god. Oh god. I don't know. I'm waiting.
I know exactly what this is.
Yeah.
I'm Slim Shady. I'm the real Slim Shady. All you want is Slim Shady. You just dip it in. Don't say I'm Slim Shady. I'm the real Slim Shady. All you want is Slim Shady. You just dip it in.
Jerry the Berry.
Jerry the Berry, 50 penny tubes. Please tell me that isn't a used condom machine. Was a used condom machine, Jerry.
Are those balls off the roof? Yeah, give a quick rinse.
Got these headsets. Oh, headsets? Sets for your head.
Hey, look, Paddy, I'm over here. I'm on the bus. I'm on the bus.
Can you hear me now? Hey, I can see you, you fucking melon.
Paddy, you've got something in a nigger cot.
Yeah, so lots of tomato sauce, please.
Baldy bouncer. Baldy bouncer.
Baldy. Baldy, baldy. We could literally
do the rest of the show.
Yeah, yeah, we could literally just do a podcast of us like quoting Phoenix Nights.
Oh, fucking hell.
Too much.
Jacuzzi. Solarium.
Piss kick? What's a piss kick?
Oh, a terrible stain at hers last night. I had to wash my old man in sink. You took your dad.
Okay. I'm broken.
The bugger is back.
Brother Nero.
Oh, God, yeah. Oh, no. The gypsy. Oh, send the buggers back. Fucking hell. Oh, Jesus.
Get them off! Get them off!
Rave on. How do you scrape the faster he goes?
Shabba. Oh dear, so we've gone from why do people leave their common sense at home because they go on holiday, when they go on holiday, to shabba.
Taking this out of... Yeah, we were... people leaving their minds at home when they go on holiday to taking the piss out of Alan's new hairdo, to quote in Phoenix Nights. This is the kind of quality that you get on this podcast.
Absolutely, and we're giving it free of charge. Absolutely amazing. Oh my god. Audio goal. Absolute audio goal. But yeah, should we actually try and tackle the question? Shall we try?
Yeah, let's give it a shot.
Yeah, why
give
not?
It a shot. We'll start with somebody that doesn't live anywhere near a touristy area. Xander, what do you think? Why do people leave their common sense at home when they go on holiday?
Because they're a bunch of morons.
You're not wrong.
Well, now, if you're going to be political about it, though, there are a bunch of morons that usually come from moronic areas, so they never had common sense to begin with.
Young farmers.
Young farmers.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah, you didn't hear the last show, did you?
Nah.
Okay, shall we indulge? They basically rip the town apart. We have a weekend every year where... Well, not every year. Last year they skipped us, didn't they? Went to Torquay.
They have 2 years on, 2 years off.
Yeah, so this is our first year. Yay. They have like a convention where a lot of farmers under a certain age, isn't it?
I think, say, a certain age, yeah, but I'm not too sure the actual guidelines.
Yeah, I don't know. But typically, they're usually in the 20s. And basically, they basically fill up pretty much every single hotel on the front and basically cause as much trouble as possible.
How can you be a farmer if you're 20 years old?
It fucking beats me.
It's more like you're a farmer's son or daughter.
Possibly. But they come here and they get fucking smashed. And there are thousands of them. And it's, yeah, they basically turned the town into a no-go area.
For they,
locals.
The town centre's an ogre area. The cords, they're just complete arseholes. They get into fights with people. They trash the place. And then they're like, oh yeah, we'll come back next year. And then all the town's like, we don't want you back.
Mm. Where are they from?
All over. All over the country. I mean, yep. For example, a couple of weeks ago, me and my partner were looking at a wedding venue. And it just so happened to be a hotel which the young farmers, or a coachload of young farmers, were just pulling up to check in. And they'd only come from Lincolnshire. So there's obviously different hotels that book up different places in the country. At that moment in time, Tiffany's, which was the hotel we were going to, they were taken in Lincolnshire. So obviously different places will take ones from Sussex, maybe other ones from Devon, another one might get some from Cumbria, Yorkshire, you know, everywhere. Up in Scotland even, possibly, I'm not sure. But, you know, they just come here, they basically treat the town like a fucking cesspool. And, yeah, it's just not good to be a fucking resident here, basically. There were some really cracking examples of their behaviour, weren't we, that we came up with. One, for example, literally they turned up on the Friday. I was walking through town because I was hanging around because, obviously, looking at the hotel. 2 hours it took for some guy to be paralytic off booze and having to be helped into the town centre, out of the town centre by an old lady.
Two hours
it took him. We got in the car, we drove off, and going down one of the roads there was young farmers they somehow managed to get litter pickers, and they were taking the hanging baskets off all the front of the hotels and throwing them at cars. And that's just what I experienced and what I've seen. There was other instances where someone that I know that I could take, obviously trustworthy in my eyes, is that there was getting inflatable penises and buggering each other in front of families of kids and things like that.
See, every farmer that I've ever met, and I'm a farmer's grandson, so none of them would even bother with something like that because they're too busy.
Well, this is their one day, so obviously the wedding planner told us, who was at Tiffany's Hotel, was like, well, to be fair, it's their one day of the year where they don't, or one weekend of the year where they actually down tools and just blow off some steam. Yes, I do get that, but what gives you an excuse to make everyone else's lives a fucking misery while you do that?
Well, that's what I'm saying. It must be rich, entitled little pricks.
Well, I
you
don't
know,
forget-
they're not, yeah. not pure farmers. But more like they stay on a farm, and they've got the workers, you know, doing all the work for them.
Possibly. Well, you know yourselves, Andrew. I used to live right next door to them.
How was that then?
Well, in Longridge. When I used to live in Longridge, mate. we tell you all the time about the drug deals and things like that going on. The fucking raids going on up the road and things like that.
Also, if you listen to the last episode, there was I typed in Young Farmers Weekend on Blackpool on Twitter, and one popped up. It was a tweet from some young girl who said, wish I was in Blackpool for Young Farmers Weekend, but Blackpool's a shithole, or something like that. So I took the sort of common decency to reply and say, yeah, especially after the farmers arrive.
Yeah, absolutely.
Didn't get a reply, but I liked it. So,
well, they what?
I didn't get a reply, but she actually liked it. I was like, you do realise I'm insulting you, yes?
Yes. Well,
yeah, but if they're self-entitled, you know, rich little pricks, then she probably wouldn't realise you were insulting her. Because you commented on her Twitter or Facebook or whatever, so she'll be over the moon.
This is true.
Well, it's I know a hotelier as well who had them staying at her hotel, and she said, hey, we put our room rates up, but like we said, we're charging them. We just said we normally, like, most will charge someone's, like, I think £30 a night or something when it's brutally quiet. But she said, oh yeah, we're charging £50 a night, but they're all paying it.
Right.
But then she's like, oh yeah, we put all the old towels out, all the old bed sets. We're taking any stuff of value out of there. It's like, so there's no TVs in there or anything. They've got no kettles in there or anything like that. They've just got the bed and, like, the window or whatever.
They're not true farmers then, because every farmer that I've ever met, they're fucking grip it as hell. So as soon as they've seen a room for anything over 20 quid, they'd be like, no, I'm going home.
Oh no, this is normally a case of like, if it's not nailed down, we'll smash it. If it's small enough, we'll take it with us or whatever. But like, even the hotel here, I know, said like, oh, if any like towels or anything go missing, they're getting charged for them. Even though it's like my old towels, because they're like, well, fuck it, they shouldn't be nicking towels, should they? Mm. That's like,
you're doing them a fucking favour. In the long run, because just get rid of the old towels. But yeah, that's just a few little examples that, you know, there was one really infamous video that's going around where a guy had his phone or his car keys chucked across the street. He actually reached in his car, grabbed it off him while he was in the car and chucked it across the street.
Well, I heard they were people had the windows open, like they were going to people's cars and literally just grabbing the car keys and then lobbing them down the prom.
Yeah.
I would have grabbed my car and fucking lamped them.
Lucky no one did. One guy nearly did, though. There was a video, was it on the Gazette, where one guy pushed back? Something like that. Yeah, the guy was lucky he didn't get fucking smashed in. I mean, last show we recorded, it was actually on Young Farmers, wasn't it? Young Farmers was happening.
The only one I remember seeing was the people. There was a load of them on Market Street. Cars were driving down. They were trying to stop cars.
Yeah, they stood in front of the buses and things like that to stop the buses moving.
One car stopped. I think it said something to him, or they said something to him. He started trying to drive off, and then one of them started trying to boot his car.
Oh, yeah.
Why be a knobhead like that?
Well, this is it. It's like all about leaving common sense at home, isn't it? Which leads nicely back into Alan's question, is why do people do that? And my reason is if it's the case for these young farmers, for example, I'm not defending them here. I still think you should have some common decency with the people that still live here. Yes, it's a touristy town, but there are people that live here, like me, like Coxie, like Alan, like Darren, that have to obviously, you know, they pick up the pieces and, you know, we have to see it on a daily basis, these fucking idiots. It's nice, it's okay, well, you're used to it. This is it, but it's the amount of damage that people do, like these young farmers do, which is bad. But the reason why I think they do it is because if they're obviously young farmers, as Xander will obviously back me up on this, they work fucking hard and they very rarely get a day off from doing it. So yeah. Do get the chance,
farmers that I know, you know, literally they're still doing stuff on the farm now, you know, at this time of night. The tractors are still out because they're seeding the field, you see, for the tatties.
Yeah.
You know, so they're up at the crack of dawn, and, you know, and out till fucking sun's gone down. And then sometimes when they're harvesting, you know, it doesn't matter if the sun's gone down, they'll finish what they need to finish. Mm-hmm. But my grandfather, he was a sheep farmer, and that was even worse. Because it doesn't really matter what's going on in your life. If the beasts need you, you need to get out in the field.
Yeah, this is it. So obviously, you know, they're working every hour God sends. And they're doing it 7 days a week. So obviously, the very little time that they get off, they are going to go fucking a little bit mental. Now, I do understand that. Obviously, a bit of common decency and a bit of common courtesy would go amiss. But I can understand the behaviour. It doesn't mean I condone it, but I can understand it. Now, obviously, when it comes, it's the same with, obviously, families going abroad. I mean, you'd say less so with families. It's more, obviously, you know, you're 18 to 30 sort of thing, which, funny enough, Thomas Cook are stopping now. They've actually stopped doing the 18 to 30 deal now, which I read somewhere for some reason. I can't remember why it's stuck in the brain, but oh well. But yeah, there was always a notorious four groups of lads and groups of girls going away, just getting fucking leathered and just being leery and things like that. Places like going to places like Ibiza and what have you, you know, that, you know, are notorious for having like party cultures and things like that. I mean, Blackpool's got a party culture now. It used to be just all family, and now obviously it's kept hold of the family sort of, you know, ideal And obviously integrated a party culture as well. Obviously, you know, if you go to town, it's just nightclubs and bars and restaurants and things like that. If you go down South Shore, it's more orientated towards families, I would say. Something like that. I don't know if, Coxie, you would agree with me on that.
Yes and no. You see, you still got like the pubs on the front, like Dutton Arms, whatever it's called, and Yatesy's.
Yeah, but there's not as many of them. I mean, you've got the casino down there, and you've got Yatesy's, you've got the Dutton Arms, like you say, you've got the Velvet Coaster, and but things like that.
There's nothing else really down there, though, for families.
Well, you've got the Pleasure Beach, you've got the Sandcastle. Your main resorts and things like that, like, you know, your things like that, your main attractions, like your theme parks and things like that, are down that way. You do have, like, you do have the tower, and you've got the piers down at north, but that's about it. Oh, Sea Life Centre, things like, you're on the mile, to say. But obviously, if you go past Coral Island, well, actually, I'd say more, even further north than that. Say the tower.
If you get to Coral Island, because you've got the show, the, what's it called?
Flagship,
that's the one.
It's like a colour chart, say, for example. Obviously, you know, when you go, like, you go white and black, and in the middle you've got grey. Coral Island's your grey. When, obviously, it goes towards that bit further north, the further north you go, the more towards the party culture it sort of goes towards. That's what I would say. Well, it's obviously going towards the Pleasure Beach, which is the south part of the promenade, is the complete opposite end of that scale. That's the way I would see it. I personally think they should be doing that with Blackpool and have basically separate. Obviously, you can't do that logistically now, obviously, but in an ideal situation, if you would do that, you'd split the town in half and say, look, that end's aimed at your families and that end's aimed at your party culture sort of thing. But obviously, that's not practical now.
No.
You know, but yes, in an ideal world, you'd do that. Now, they're never going to get that balance as much as they're going to try it in Blackpool. You know, you're going to get that people that come into Blackpool because it's got a reputation for being a party place. It's also got a reputation for being family orientated as well. So you're always going to get that clash. For example, the Young Farmers Weekend, and then you get people coming down on bank holiday because they'll bring the family to Blackpool for the day. The next thing you know, you're seeing young farmers buggering each other with inflatable penises.
Yeah.
You know, so you're going to get that clash, and it can't be helped.
The thing that I don't get, though, is, like, especially working in tourist attractions and stuff, the amount of people that come here that can't flush a toilet.
Oh, God. Yeah. How, like I say, common sense stays at home. They just, like, they'll do whatever they got to do. And they probably, if you're honest with me, they've not had time to flush the toilet. They probably don't even wash their hands, the dirty bastards.
That's fucking minging that on its own.
Yeah, they do it a lot in Blackpool, mate. It's fucking awful. I also, like I say, another thing that I need to think, I think is why people do all this shit and they leave the common sense at home and they do whatever the fuck they want to do. Is because they think, well, I'm not going to see him again, and if I do, it's going to be in a year's time, and I've probably forgotten. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, I could just do this. They won't give a shit.
Yeah.
In a year's time. They won't give a flying fuck. So, yeah, people will do that. And that's for another reason why they'll just think, oh, just fuck it, who cares? So I think that's another reason. There's many a reason why people leave the common sense behind. And like I say, blowouts, just because they can. You know, or maybe just a complete fucking morons to begin with. There's that. But at the same time, you do get the tourists that come, and they do have the common sense, and they do the right thing. You know, it's six of one half dozen other sometimes, but you do tend to find in Blackpool that the people that have no common sense, and they're just here to have a good time, in air quotations, and, you know, be a bit rowdy, tend to be the ones that stick out like a sore thumb.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't really fault it. They're very loud. Very noisy. Forced segue!
Just because you scream any louder.
Well, no. Because you have to turn your headphones up. Speaking of headphones, studio.
Studio.
Exactly. I have to talk about Studio headphones, or Studio headphones, very briefly. Recently, why? Because we have an agreement with Studio.com, which are a fine website to get your headphones from. I got myself a free set from Studio.com. They are the Regent Black. I believe Lewis also got a set of these headphones.
I'm currently wearing my pair at the moment.
So, what do you think of your Studio headphones?
Very much like them.
Mm-hmm. The weight is absolutely perfect. Like I said last week, it feels like you're wearing nothing at all.
Nothing at all. Nothing at all. Stupid sexy Flinders.
Absolutely.
They weigh next to nothing. They rest comfortably on your ears, and given that I have big, massive ears,
everyone else is... The past 2 hours right now.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're still as comfortable as when you put them on.
Oh, yeah. They come with a wire, or they can connect to any sort of Bluetooth device, which came in very handy earlier today when I was out sunbathing in the sun, and I was using my said Studio headphones to watch the Best Super Juniors show from this morning.
Absolutely.
So they didn't have any trailing wires or anything like that. No. It's just free and easy.
And the range on them is fucking fantastic. You get a 10-meter range
without
any disturbance in the signal quality.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's obviously we're not taking into account brick walls and things like that. But even so, that's a really good range. So, and the build, like I say, the build quality is top notch. You can adjust them because the headphones move up and down on either side. You know, yep. You can adjust them. So basically, any shape, if you've got even a triangle shaped head, for fuck's sake, for argument's sake, you could get these headphones on your head to fit comfortably. So, did you manage to use your promo code?
I did manage to use my promo code, yeah.
You ought to use your promo code, and... like Lewis, if you go to studio.com, that's Studio.com, and when you get to you click whatever, there's a wide range of headphones, starting from like £29, going all the way up to like £129. Really good brand, really good selection, really wide like colours, all sorts. You can customise the Regent ones that me and Lewis have. You can actually customise the end plates on the side of your headphones. They twist up and you can change them. You can buy replacement ones from the website. But just remember, if you go to studio.com and you go to use the promo code RAD, you get yourself a cool 50% off your order. So, yeah, get yourself over. Get yourself a decent set of headphones, like Lewis. And, just enjoy improved sound quality. Like I said last week, I would put them on par, if not better, than Dre's. So they are that good.
No. That's a bad advertisement.
Dre's are shit.
Yes, they're fucking awful. That was not a good ad.
No, fair enough. But yeah, studio.com have really good headphones. I cannot fault them in any shape or form. Fantastic fucking headphones. Get yourself to studio.com, Studio.com. Use the promo code RAD and you will get 15% off your total order at the checkout. So, yeah, Xander, that's where you're getting your next headphones.
No, it's really not.
Xander, you are. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink.
It'd be a way of helping out Paul.
Okay, I'm really not.
Yes.
Oh, dear. Don't be like Xander. This is Xander. Xander doesn't like great audio quality. Xander doesn't like studio.com. Don't be like Xander.
Oh, dear, mate. So when did you pick up a sponsor?
Hey, it was a couple of weeks ago. A few weeks ago.
Sorry, then.
So,
It's not a sponsorship. It's more of a scratch my back, scratch yours sort of thing.
Ah, cool.
So, yeah, they're cool. Studio.com, really cool. Can't fault them.
Was this through, Paul?
Sorry?
Where was this deal sorted through?
Oh, it was sorted through the Britpod scene, where you can find great podcasts such as Rough Giraffe, Master Debaters, Casam Earth, These People Podcast, Lost Art of Podcasting, Lost Art of Wrestling, and many, 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 many more. Get yourself over on... Oh, and of course, WrestleBox.
Thanks, mate. Cheers.
Yeah, we're on there. We're on there, affiliated. We're on there. So yeah, get yourself over to Britpod Scene. There's also, like I say, great selection of British podcasts that are out there. So treat your ears to another great British podcast while you're there, and obviously listen to us.
Does Studio listen to you?
I think they have.
Well, I would like to add. No, it's constructive feedback.
Careful now.
An over-ear version, not an on-ear.
Over-ear?
Yeah, over-ear is what is the most comfortable, because it just, your ears then sit inside the headphones.
That may be a work in progress, we do not know.
Over-ear headphones are far more comfortable.
Mm. But these obviously are, you know, your bog standard headphone sort of cover, and they are nice. They are comfortable, I cannot fault them. So on that note, yeah, Coxie, have you got anything you want to add, mate?
Nothing comes to mind.
I think we're done. We're up to 2 hours, 5 minutes. So I think on that note...
Thank you,
Dan. Xander's got another brew. We'll have a very, very brief 5 minute break, and then we'll close the show, because it's Darren time!
Oh, hooray!
Back in 5 minutes.
Hello. Hi, it's Darren here. Just a quick talk about what's coming up in less than a month's time. Yeah, that's right. It's the World Cup 2018 held in Russia. We've had the England squad announced. My feelings, yes. Can we do it? Nah. My feelings, it'd probably be something to do with penalties or something like that. The usual. That's what happens. But I eat my words. If it doesn't happen. If it happens, I mean. Anyway. What are the feelings on any other teams that we have, guys? I just want to ask you that. Is there any teams that you think are underdogs? Teams that you think will win it? Or not going to win it? Any thoughts on the World Cup going into it? I mean, it's held in Russia, and Russia's a proper mad place. I mean, strict place. I mean, the fans, I do not feel happy for the envious of those fans. Some of the travel advice that they've been giving out about how to register your vote, and you have to be this and that, and you have to be have your passport and all this done, and that's one thing. But then they've got the football hooliganism over there is mental. So you're just like, wow, what can you do? I'm just like thinking to myself, I would not want to mess with anyone in Russia over this World Cup. Is it going to be a good tournament, you think, or a bad tournament? Or, I mean, the current champions are Germany. Are they going to win it again? I don't know. Being English man, British man, whatever it is. I don't want Germany to win it again, because, you know, we're meant to be big rivals, but hey, they've got a decent squad, and if they can do good now, then yeah. I don't really know much more about it, to be honest with you. I'm normally up to everything, and I'm just like thinking to myself, looking at teams and thinking, who shall we have? Who shall we have winning this? And who's who and what's happening? The grounds, what I've seen on some of the pictures, look crazy, but what can you do? I'm just looking at the squad. At least the time difference is not too bad, which for me is good. I mean, and most of the games, well, the England games, they're kicking off. I mean, the first game, first English game kicks off at 18th of June at 7 o'clock against Tunisia. I mean, that's not too bad for a day for a football game, 7 o'clock. And then they've got the final game sets at 4 o'clock on 15th of July. I mean, looking at the times and dates for these games, not too bad. Does anyone remember? I'm sure there was a World Cup a few years ago that was 6 in the morning, 7 in the morning time difference. I remember going to a pub at like 9, 10 in the morning to watch the game, and it was crazy. So, guys, who do you think is going to win the World Cup? Who do you think is going to get knocked out first? If England has won the advantage, you've correct, you won a prize. Anyway, I'd love to talk more about the World Cup with you. Maybe later on we'll talk more about who is going to be in the World Cup squad, and maybe I'll do a little teaser for you. Never know. Bye.
And we're back. So yeah, that was Darren talking about this year's World Cup in Russia 2018. In Russia, yeah. We already know the year. Fucking hell. Yeah, Darren asked us a very quick question before we go. Who's going to win the World Cup?
Germany, probably.
Yeah, all I would say is not us.
I don't give a flying fuck.
The Germans.
Yeah, I can't see past the Germans.
It'll either be the Germans or maybe Brazil.
Yeah, the usual.
Maybe Brazil.
Yeah,
the and usual not because of Neymar, but because Bobby Firmino has been included in the World Cup squad.
Yeah,
and I'm made up for him because he's been. To talk very briefly about Liverpool, if Mo Salah hadn't been there this season, he'd probably be, you know, in talks of being one of the best players in the Premier League.
Yeah, I'd say so.
He's gone under the radar, I reckon.
Yeah, because of how good Salah's been.
Yep.
Yeah. So shall we ask our resident football expert what he thinks he's going to win the World Cup?
Jamaica.
Who is that resident expert footballer?
Coxie. Footballer expert. Coxie, who's going to win the World Cup?
In Soviet Russia, Kof wins you.
Let's all just watch cool runnings and say Jamaica for everything.
Yeah, Jamaica. Yes, I think Jamaica's going to win the World Cup. What about you, Lewis?
Why not a man?
It's Jamaica. Coxie.
I don't care either way.
Jamaica, then. Xander.
Oh, it has to be Jamaica.
So, right, we're all in agreement. Jamaica is winning the World Cup. So let's see
Jamaica, how wrong we are. Jamaica. Jamaica. We'll put a quid on it.
Because Jamaica now has a football team.
So one of them gets the ball and runs towards the actual goal, just going, cool runnings!
Do you think they'll just get confused and run past the line and start celebrating, thinking they've just won a race?
Yeah, but it would be more entertaining, wouldn't it?
It would be. Did you see the kick off and, and you just hear the referee blow his whistle and they all just start sprinting towards the other side of the pitch?
Most amount of running you'd see in
football. Scratching his head going, what the fuck?
It's the most amount of running you'd see in football.
They do it quicker than anyone else, at least.
Be like fucking. You ever seen Harry Enfield's TV program where they do like the footy special of like Arsenal from the 1950s versus Liverpool from the 1980s? And they've got like Donny on the wing, and all he literally does is just sort of like take one touch, goes the other way, takes another touch, and he literally just goes back and forth in between.
Rings a bell. Does ring a bell.
I remember that fondly from my childhood. Yeah.
Yeah, Harry Enfield was amazing. So, yeah, that's. I think that's going to be us for tonight. I think we'll just wrap it up right there, nice and abruptly. Yeah. So, yeah, guys, thanks for coming on tonight. Been an absolute pleasure, as usual.
As per, thanks for having me on. Yeah.
Not a problem, always welcome. So, yeah, obviously you can catch RAD Live on Spreaker live every other Saturday, but you can also find us, you know, after the show on Spreaker, but also on iTunes or iMusic or whatever the fuck they're going by nowadays. Spreaker, Stitcher, YouTube, and most other good podcast catchers out there. Coxie, do you want to give yourself some plugs, mate?
Yeah, Final Lost Art Podcast on Facebook, Twitter at Lost Art Podcast, Instagram, Patreon, give us money.
Yes, money.
give me money.
Give me money on taking your thumbs.
Catches, so yeah, there we go.
Absolutely. That's what I also forgot to mention as well. Obviously, we are also on Patreon. We are working on content. I'm writing it. It is hard. So yeah, throw us some money, throw us a bone or two, help us keep the lights on, keep us going, and we'll reward you with content and perks. You can obviously, it's www.patreon.com/RAD Live Podcast or RAD Live. Yeah, you can also, like I say, find us on facebook.com/UKRAD Podcast. We are at UKRAD Podcast on Twitter. Where else are we at? I think that is it, isn't it?
I think so.
Think that is it. Obviously, you can find our friends, These People Podcast, on Facebook as well. They have a website, www.thesepeoplepodcast.com. The Cast of Earth Podcast, check them out. They're on Stitcher. They also got the Facebook page. Just search for them there. Mooch TV is www.youtube.com/MoochTV. Do they have Facebook? They're on Facebook, aren't they, Coxie? But can they remember the web address?
Yeah, just search Mooch TV.
There you go. You'll find them. You'll find them. Anyone else we need to plug? Mystery Island, it's the Facebook page. They have, it's www.facebook.com/back2 The Island.
I think Mystery Island has ceased to exist because they've moved forward with Wrestle Island.
Ah, okay. But this page is still there.
Page is still there, but I don't think it gets posted anymore. It's because they've sort of, I think they ceased the shopper, but they're moving forward as an actual wrestling company.
Right, in that case, then erase that plug from your mind. It never happened. Other than that, yeah, I think we're done. Lewis, you want to say add anything before we go?
I'll plug the WrestleBox podcast.
Go for it.
You can find it on Facebook, on Twitter. The episodes get posted to the RAD Live feed on Spreaker, so you can check them out there. Mm-hmm. It's posted the very first show last week. It's on speaker.com/RAD podcast. I'm going to be recording for the next podcast either tomorrow or Monday. We'll be talking about the All In independent show and how the tickets sold out in less than half an hour. Also, the first two nights from the Best Super Juniors tournament, we'll be talking about that stuff from being the elite and maybe a couple of other things as well.
So, yeah, Feast of Independent Wrestling right for you there. I am working on getting you on iTunes, so we will get there eventually, which will get you on Stitcher and other places too. So don't you worry, we'll get you there. Yeah, other than that, I think that is it. Xander, you want anything you want to add?
Nope.
Your own, what about your own YouTube channel, perhaps? If all, because you've got racing footage on there, things like that.
Yeah, but I've been too lazy to put anything on it for about 2 months now.
There's still footage on there. Give yourself a plug.
Look for Xander MCN on YouTube.
There you go. And I think that is it. Coxie, you want anything else you want to plug?
Nothing.
Sink or your bath or whatever it is.
With hair.
With hair.
No, not to mind.
Fair enough then. And on that case then, thank you guys for listening. It's been a pleasure. Thank you and good night. And all that's left to say is, I've been Paul the Hat Guy Flinders.
I've been Xander.
I've been Scarce1 Lewis Ogden, in the immortal words of Jim Cornette.
Thank you, fuck you, bye, boom.
And I have been the last one.
Oh, you can't top that, sadly, can you? Not without preparation. Well,
I'm going to keep pushing my campaign of being the last one to say goodbye from now on.
That's going to happen. I'll make sure that is the case.
Well, tell that's fucking Coxie, because he intentionally waits until I go.
Coxie's going to fucking push. Other than that note, then, we'll leave it there. Thank you for listening. See you next time. Thank you and good night.
Ta-ra.
Take a walk down by the sea, picking up colored shells in the sand. Seagull, I want your wings. Silver circus in a cloudy land. The black sky's face. Seagull, I can hear you calling. Time and space. I want to know how it makes you feel. The work your restless wings can't.
This podcast is part of Britpod Scene, an independent network of uniquely British podcasts that's always growing. Check out BritpodScene.com or BritpodScene on Twitter to find out more.